Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hope for Ukraine, Stories of Grit and Grace from the Front Lines of War, by Kyle Duncan and Esther Fedorkevich. Foreword by John Bevere and Lisa Bevere. Narrated by Kyle Duncan. To Corey Zhenya Duncan, who inspired all of this. Kyle. To my Ukrainian grandparents. Esther. Foreword. We love the people of Ukraine and have both had the privilege of ministering in their nation. What stood out to us most was their unrelenting resilience, genuine kindness, and gracious generosity. I can still remember a very special lunch. Our family was hosted in the home of a Ukrainian mother and her three daughters. They were Christians who had immigrated to the United States. After lunch, we sat in their living room as the daughters played Vivaldi with such passion and excellence that we wept. What we experienced that day typifies the tenacious Ukrainian beauty. It is a nation that has endured the cruelty of both communism and war, yet its people cling to the belief that they are destined for more. Our hearts sank when we heard the news of the Russian invasion, and like so many, our team is praying for a swift resolution so that justice and peace would again reign in their land. When we heard Kyle Duncan and Esther Fedorkevich had compiled a book to grant each of us a window into the lives of these extraordinary people, we were honored to add our voice to theirs. As you listen, let's believe in the hope that one day the destiny of Ukraine will far surpass the pain of her history. John and Lisa Bevere, co-founders, Messenger International, best-selling authors and ministers. Acknowledgments. Kyle would like to thank my wife, Suzanne. Here's to my best friend and partner, who has loved me in the worst of times and the best. My daughters, Hannah, Kylie, and Zoe, for helping me laugh in the midst of chaos. My son, Corey Zhenya, for showing me the face of bravery. Your Ukrainian heart is huge. My siblings, Kimmy, Kirk, and Chrissy, for your unconditional support. My sister, Carrie, our sunset beach walks provided the fuel for my often empty tank. My mom, Stella Frances Duncan. Those childhood trips to the Glendale Public Library paid off, Mom. And my late dad, Robert, who modeled a love for both God and the arts. The team at Baker Publishing Group and Chosen Books, Dwight Baker, thank you for immediately saying yes and circumventing Pub Board, a miracle in itself. Kim Banks, my editor and friend of three decades, you are a true sister, and your wisdom and compassion precede you. Deirdre Close, Rebecca Schreiner, Dan Pitts, Trish Kinesny, and Natasha Sperling, for your excellent work behind the scenes. Stas Glinka Verbicki, my interpreter and co-traveler, your ability to speak four languages was the difference maker, and this book would not have been possible without you. Yuri Safanov, your help on the ground was indispensable. Johnny and Ira Semenyuk and Maryana Kravchenko, your introductions led to many of these stories. Friends who have always been there, Keith Wall, Tim Peterson, Bill Schultz, Tim Weir, and Mike Greenberg. Benji Horning, who helped kick this whole thing off, Alan Jones, a true brother, Mike, Steve, and the rest of my Wednesday night mates, and fellow writer Rick Killian, who understands. My co-author, Esther Fedorkevich, thank you for your partnership, for your support, and for instantly seeing the vision. A host of praying folks who have lifted us up, including Brent Weidman, Brad Haru, Pamela Nishimoto, Israel Hanna, Kay Hiramini, and Patrick Jarvis, and Jesus, without whom I'd be utterly adrift. Esther would like to thank my parents, Paul and Nina Chodnowitz, Ukrainian immigrants who came to the U.S. to raise their family. Thank you for raising us with Ukrainian traditions and values and for providing so many opportunities for your kids. My husband, Jimmy, and my kids, Alexei Jane and Paul Gregory, for always being there to support me. There are always so many people behind the scenes making books happen. I'd like to thank my team at the Fed Agency, Danielle, Kyle, Brittany, Tyler, Allie, Darren, Tori, Ashley, Ginny, and Caitlin. Thank you for loving books as much as I do. A big thank you to the Baker Books team for helping us turn this idea for a project into a beautiful book. For every book sold, I am donating 100% of my royalties to Ukrainian families whose lives were impacted during the war. Historical Ukraine. If you are unfamiliar with Ukraine's long and eventful history but want to know more, we are including the following timelines. While by no means exhaustive, they cover the country's key historical events from roughly 700 BC through the 19th century, and then from the beginning of the 20th century to the present time. In brief, Ukraine's early history, between 700 BC and 200 BC, ruled by the Scythian Kingdom, predating this period, thought to be the region responsible for the domestication of the horse. Between 500 BC and AD 500, Roman, Greek, and Byzantine colonies established along the Black Sea. In 370, the Goths are succeeded by the Huns. Between 400 and 500 AD, early Slavic and Antes peoples, including migrations from areas of present-day Ukraine into the Balkans, and the creation of South Slavic nations. In 650, the Bulgar nomadic kingdom. By 700, the Khazar nomadic kingdom. In 882, Prince Oleg of Novgorod conquers Kyiv and makes it capital of the Rus. From 882 to 1240 was the golden age of Kyiv. The Kievan Rus kingdom included much of present-day Ukraine, Russia, and Belarus. Between 980 and 1015 was the reign of Vladimir the Great and alignment with Byzantine Christianity. 1240, the Mongol invasion and the decline of the Kievan Rus. Between 1199 and 1253 saw the kingdom of Galicia Volhynia, vassal of the Golden Horde. 1253 to 1349, the kingdom of Ruthenia, vassal of the Golden Horde. Between 1349 and 1648, control by the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. In 1648 was the conquest of Kyiv by Cossack Bohdan Khmelnytsky. 1648 to 1764 was the Cossack Hetmanate. From 1764 until 1781, Empress of Russia, Catherine the Great, integrates most of central Ukraine into the Russian Empire. It remains part of the Russian Empire until 1917. 1783, Russian annexation of Crimea from the Crimean Khanate and the Tatars. From 1814 to 1895, we see the rise of Ukrainian nationalism, influenced by Taras Shevchenko and Mikhailo Drahomanov. In brief, Ukraine since the 20th century. Between 1900 and 1914, there's an increase in migration throughout Russia and a rise in Ukrainian nationalism. Between 1914 and 1918, World War I sees nearly 4 million Ukrainians fight for the Imperial Russian Army and the Austro-Hungarian Army. Between 1917 and 1920, Ukrainian People's Republic, short-lived independence after the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917, February and October Revolutions. 1917 to 1921 is the Ukrainian-Soviet War. This was the War of Independence. Several conflicts to assert Ukrainian independence, albeit briefly retained. 1922, absorption into newly formed Soviet Union as a Ukrainian Socialist Soviet Republic. The 1920s and 1930s, we see the rise of nationalism and Ukrainization, the rise of Ukrainian language and culture. Between 1930 and 1933, we see the Holodomor. It's a Soviet famine which kills 4 million Ukrainians. Between 1939 and 1945, World War II leads to the death of 1.5 million Ukrainian Jews by the Nazis. In 1954, we see the transfer of control of Crimea from USSR to the Ukrainian Socialist Soviet Republic. 1991 is the fall of the USSR and the establishment of an independent Ukraine. Between 2004 and 2008, the Orange Revolution and power struggle between pro-Western and pro-Russian parties. On November 23, 2013, Euromaidan pro-democracy demonstrations begin in Kyiv. From February 18 to the 23rd, 2014, the Revolution of Dignity leads to the deaths of 121 people. On February 22nd of 2014, President Viktor Yanukovych flees Kyiv for Russia. Between February 20th and March 26, 2014, the Russian annexation of Crimea. On April 16th, 2014, to the present, the war in Donbas. On May 25th, 2014, Petro Poroshenko is elected president of Ukraine. Then on May 20th, 2019, former comedian and television actor Volodymyr Zelensky is elected president of Ukraine. On February 24th of 2022, the Russian invasion of Ukraine begins. Chapter 1, True Stories of Hope for Ukraine. This is a book of true stories captured between late February and late May 2022. I, Kyle, spent 3 weeks in Poland and Western Ukraine in late March and early April, interviewing those who had fled the war, as well as aid workers and volunteers. I also conducted numerous interviews with Ukrainians who remain in the country. In compiling the stories, the goal was to give voice to those affected by Russia's February 24, 2022 invasion. In essence, we wanted to get out of the way and let the story speak for themselves. My co-author, Esther Fedorkevich, and I did not set out to produce a comprehensive overview of the war in Ukraine. Nor do we claim to be military analysts or geopolitical experts. Rather, similar to an ice core sample extracted from a glacier, the stories represent a sliver of history from a specific time and place. Our goal was simple: tell the stories of real Ukrainians living through the largest and most devastating war in Europe in 8 decades. Esther's maternal Ukrainian grandparents fled religious persecution and Stalin's Holodomor, the man-made famine that killed more than 4 million Ukrainians in the early 1930s. Her grandmother and grandfather walked across the border into China, looking for a better life for their children. Her paternal grandparents left Ukraine in 1928, seeking better opportunities in Argentina before immigrating to New Jersey in the 1960s. Esther's husband, Jimmy, is also Ukrainian-American. My connection to Ukraine is through my adopted son, Zhenya, who was 6 when my wife, Suzanne, and I adopted him in 2007 from an orphanage in Mariupol. I spent nearly a month there and grew to love the people and culture. Since then, our family has been closely following events in Ukraine, particularly for the past 8 years. Esther and I rejoiced when Ukraine emerged from the Maidan Revolution in early 2014 with a newly formed pro-democracy government. And then we quickly grew concerned when Russia annexed the Crimea a short time later. Our concern turned to deep worry when the war in Donbas broke out. It was yet another connection point for Esther, who has relatives in Ukraine, and for me. All the people featured in this book are real, and their stories have been retold as accurately as possible. We often only use first names, and at times, names are changed to protect the identities of the speakers. When we do use aliases, we make note of it. Esther and I are Christians who have a combined 50-plus years of experience working in faith-based publishing. Yet, while some of the stories come from a faith perspective, we did not set out exclusively to pick faith stories. Rather, our intent was to tell the stories of the people I met and interviewed as accurately as they were told to me. Also, proceeds from this book will be donated to aid organizations helping Ukraine's refugees. The word hope in this book's title can be read as both a noun and a verb. While we believe there is hope for Ukraine, we also believe it's critical to hope and to pray for peace. Ultimately, we hope this book gives you an intimate glimpse into the lives of some extraordinary people who have endured terrible hardships with grit and grace. Slava Ukraini! Heroim Slava! Chapter 2. Dmitriy, Maryana, and Max. With her husband, Dmitriy, still sleeping, Maryana Kravchenko steps onto the balcony of the 15th-floor studio apartment they've rented in Zaporizhia, in south-central Ukraine. She has a panoramic view of a city that has not yet awakened to the news of Russian military invasion. It's very quiet on the pre-dawn morning of February 24th, 2022. Maryana has risen in the dark to pray and has escaped to the balcony for a time of worship. Her heart is heavy, but she prays into that, asking God to soften the heart of a judge who has so far delayed the adoption process of their 16-year-old son, Maxim, or Max, on several occasions. She also prays that the rumors of a Russian invasion of Ukraine will not materialize. Earlier in February, the couple had received news back home in Pennsylvania that the Ukrainian judge in their adoption process was finally ready to hear their case. In fact, the judge had agreed to a virtual court date of February 16th. 4 days before the hearing, however, the judge changed her mind. "You know what? No, you have to come in. I have to see you." The in-person court date was scheduled to take place on February 16th in the village where Max's orphanage was located, about 120 kilometers west of Zaporizhia. On short notice, the Kravchenkos made the 1,000-mile drive from their home in Bucks County, Pennsylvania, to Tampa, Florida, so Mariana's mom could take care of their three biological children, Esther, Miriam, and Moses. They then boarded a three-legged flight set to arrive in Kyiv on February 14th, 2 days before many U.S. news outlets predicted the war might start. Upon arriving in Amsterdam, they discovered that their Delta flight to Kyiv had been canceled. In fact, many carriers' flights to Ukraine were falling off the departures board at Schiphol International. Fortunately, Ukrainian airlines were still operating flights, and the couple arrived at Kyiv's Boryspil International Airport later that day. Upon arrival, they received the news that the judge had contracted COVID-19, so the in-person court hearing was postponed. Every couple of days, the judge would feed them information. "Maybe in a couple more days," she would say. Finally, the judge's secretary called and said the appointment was confirmed for Friday, February 25th at 2:45 p.m. "One more day until this is all over," thinks Maryana as she stares out at a city still asleep. The only sound, the low hum of a distant airplane. At first, the sound is faint, and Maryana doesn't think anything of it. But then the sound grows louder, and she realizes she's hearing the deep buzz of not one airplane, but several. She leaves the balcony and tries to wake up her husband. "I hear aircraft," she says to Dmitriy. "Do you think they are warplanes?" "Go back to sleep. It's still dark out," he says. Max is sleeping in an adjacent room. The court has allowed him to spend several days with them, and they've been enjoying their time together. Maryana glances at her phone lying on the nightstand, alarmed to see several messages from relatives and friends in the United States, some of whom she hasn't talked to in 15 years. The images in the news links are terrifying, bombs dropping and buildings on fire. As she sits on the edge of the bed, she says, "It's happening, Dmitriy. And I just heard warplanes when I was out on the balcony." Not long after waking up Dmitriy, Maryana receives a call from the court secretary. "The judge wants to see you this morning. It can't wait until tomorrow. You need to get in your car and drive here now." As they leave Zaporizhia with Max to begin the 2.5-hour drive to the courthouse, they pray that the process will go smoothly. They are encouraged by the experience of a neighbor back in Pennsylvania who had adopted from the nearby town of Burdansk 2 months earlier. The judge in that case asked the parents two questions and waived the 30-day waiting period. Unfortunately, however, as soon as Dmitriy, Maryana, and Max walk into the courtroom, they can tell it's going to be a long morning. The judge immediately sets an aggressive tone. "If this adoption is approved, I'm telling you right now that I will not waive the 30-day waiting period." She then starts in on Max, interrogating him belligerently. "Why do you want to go to America with this wealthy couple?" the judge says. At one point, she yells at Max and asks if he is being forced to go to the United States against his will. He says no, that he wants to go, and that it was his decision, and that he wants to be a part of the Kravchenko family. The judge then turns her ire on the Kravchenkos. "You must be very wealthy to be here. Are you millionaires?" she says. "Who are you? Pamela Anderson and Tommy Lee? Do you have a live-in nanny? How else can you take care of four children?" They tell her no, they are not wealthy, and no, they don't have a live-in nanny. And Maryana says, "I am their mom. I will take care of them." Maryana, originally from Lviv, and Dmitriy, from Odessa, are now U.S. citizens. "It angered her that we were Ukrainians who now live in America," says Dmitriy. After 2 hours of grueling questions, the adoption is approved, but the 30-day waiting period is upheld. The Kravchenkos plead their case, noting that Russia's military invasion has started that very morning, and they just want to get their son someplace safe. Can the judge please waive the 30-day waiting period? "Family court has nothing to do with war," the judge snaps back. "It does if you're leaving your son behind," thinks Maryana, stifling the urge to say the words out loud. Despite their best efforts to convince the judge otherwise, she cannot be swayed. The family now faces a major dilemma. Where will Max go as he waits out the 30-day period? Maryana confides, "The judge did not want Max to leave Ukraine. She believed that by enforcing the 30-day waiting period, Max would change his mind, even during wartime, with bombs going off." Dmitriy, a building contractor, and Maryana, an optometrist, had both arranged 2 weeks off from their respective jobs. And with three young children waiting for them back in Tampa, their 2 weeks are running out. They have to make the excruciating decision to leave without Max, as it would be impossible to stay in Ukraine for another month. Max is one of 10 orphan children, including four younger siblings who live in adoptive families and four older ones who are independent. Max and his remaining sibling, Bogdan, live in an orphanage and attend a nearby trade school. The Kravchenkos first met Max and Bogdan in December 2018 through an international hosting program. It's a great way for orphans to experience another culture and lifestyle, which also allows prospective parents to get to know potential adoption candidates. Though Max loved visiting Bucks County, Pennsylvania, and seemed like a natural fit with the Kravchenko family, Bogdan didn't want to return to the United States. Over the next 3 years, Max would make three more visits to stay with the Kravchenkos. During those visits, a deep bond developed between Max, Dmitriy, Maryana, and their three biological children. Bogdan, 2 years older than Max, had a serious girlfriend and wanted to remain in Ukraine. And due to complexities in the Ukrainian adoption system, Max could not be adopted until his older brother Bogdan aged out or turned 18. So the family had to press pause on the adoption while Max stayed in the orphanage, waiting 2 years until Bogdan's 18th birthday. The brothers had a fragmented relationship and argued and fought often. The Kravchenkos did everything they could to try to help Max. They sent shoes, clothes, and other necessities to the orphanage, and they prayed constantly for his safety. In August 2021, Max's brother turned 18, and the Kravchenkos were set to pursue Max's adoption. With their dossier complete and fully translated, an October court date was set, which was then delayed until December 4th. Due to backlogs in the region's adoption system, COVID-19 complications, and other delays beyond the Kravchenkos' control, all they could do was wait and pray. As December approached, the date was again moved, this time to January 21st, 2022. And then that date was then pushed back to February 16th. A 3.5-year journey came down to this. With war descending upon the Zaporizhia area and the Kravchenkos' inability to stay in country any longer, mother, father, and newly adopted son might have to say goodbye once again. Dmitriy tries one more time, asking the trade school director, "Listen, I have family in Odessa who can look after Max. Can we take him there?" "You can," says the director, "but you can go to jail for that." Exhibiting maturity well beyond his 16 years, Max says, "Listen, Dad, we aren't going to break the law. I'll be okay. I'm going to stay here and lay low." "We bought Max a lot of food and said our goodbyes," says Maryana. Max had prayed to accept Christ a few days earlier while we were all visiting Dmitriy's family in Odessa, so we prayed together one last time. We understood that the journey could come to an end right there, and we knew that we might not see one another until heaven. Tearing themselves away from this emotional scene, Dmitriy and Maryana board a train out of Zaporizhia back to Kyiv. From there, they plan to speed west by car, trying to make it to the Polish border. Soon, the Ukrainian army is blowing bridges into Kyiv to slow the Russian assault, so there are few routes out of the city. Because of these limitations, the traffic is at a near standstill, and it takes 7 hours just to leave Kyiv's outskirts. Many people are walking or biking out of the city. The couple can hear bombs going off in the suburbs around Kyiv, places like Irpin and Bucha. And they can see Ukrainian tanks and infantry camouflaged just inside the tree line of the forest that hugs Auto Route E-40. The Kravchenkos had been in touch with the U.S. State Department due to the sensitive nature of things on the ground. Putin had been massing Russian troops along the Ukrainian border for months now, and there was wide speculation that an invasion was imminent. "Once the war actually broke out, the State Department contacted me," Maryana said. They said, "Hello, Maryana, do you and Dmitriy mind leaving Ukraine?" It was polite like that, as if the official were asking Maryana to return a baking dish. Maryana can smile about it now. "I assured them that we were, at that moment, headed for the Polish border. It was actually comforting to know that the State Department was able to contact us and check on our safety." The couple arrived in western Ukraine, and one scene in particular sticks in Mariana's mind. "We roll up to one Ukrainian checkpoint, and it's completely manned by normal Ukrainian guys from the local village. Most were older men in civilian clothes, and it was just comforting to see the solidarity, how the whole country was helping out." After crossing the border into Poland, they track down a bus that will take them to Warsaw. Dmitriy explains, "When we board the bus, the people are looking at me suspiciously. I have to explain that I'm not running from the war, but that I am an American. I felt like that guy on the Titanic who was the only man in the lifeboat with the women and children. Healthy male Ukrainian citizens between the ages of 18 and 60 are not allowed to leave the country and are required to fight or serve the war effort in other ways. In the meantime, Max has taken shelter in his trade school building. Even though it's illegal for him to leave Ukraine for 30 days, all the courthouse workers have fled the country. Even his trade school director has fled to Western Ukraine, the same person who warned the Krevchenkos that if they took Max to Odessa, they could be thrown in jail. Maryana opens her Telegram app and sees a message from Max, telling her that there's a World War II bomb shelter that older folks have rediscovered in the village. It had been used by their family members to hide from the Nazis 80 years earlier. Ukrainian soldiers have just recently arrived and are running out of ammunition. Some of the older villagers show the soldiers where the shelter is, and they dig down to reach the iron doors. A Ukrainian army tank is parked near the shelter entrance. Even Max's brother is in the shelter. "We were praying the Lord's Prayer and reading the New Testament," says Max. Max gets to know some of the soldiers, some not much older than he is, and one of them says, "Listen, kid, get out while you can." Max asks a friend to take him in a taxi to flee the city, but Max's orphanage director becomes quite upset and tells Max he needs to return to the shelter. So while Max's friend heads to Odessa, Max obeys and returns to the bomb shelter. By this time, news of the shelter has spread in the area, and there are up to 500 people seeking refuge there. The brothers are together in the bomb shelter for 12 days. Water and electricity have been knocked out, so a few people go to the local church and ask the Orthodox priest for candles. The church gives them armloads, enough to light the shelter for several days. As the days go by, Russian artillery strikes intensify. The strikes come in cycles, and the brothers count the hits. At one point, Bogdan says, "The next time it starts, we won't have to count to 15. The bombing starts, and the boys start counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. At 11, they begin to recite the Lord's Prayer, and the bombing stops. The Kravchenkos contact multiple organizations on the ground in an attempt to exfiltrate Max from his village, which is now a hotly contested war zone. People are well-meaning, but they tell us that it's just too dangerous, and it would be suicide to try to get them, Dmitriy said. Max knows that if he goes above ground, he could be killed. The bombing is that intense. And at night, when it's safer to emerge, there's a curfew in place, and anyone out past 5 can be shot. So they have to stay put. Finally, Maryana reaches a war chaplain named Albert Homiak, who works with Republic Pilgrim and its founder, Gennady Monchnenko, in Mariupol. These are amazing people who have been working with homeless and orphan kids in the Mariupol area for 25 years and do frontline work with soldiers, says Maryana. Republic Pilgrim has been on the front lines during the 8-year war in Donbass and is now working around the clock in the heavily bombed city of Mariupol and surrounding areas. The Kravchenkos speak to Albert, and he says he's in a village not too far from Max that is under heavy attack. Albert tells them that he's very close to Max, but the entire area is becoming too dangerous. "We can go get your son, but we have to go now," says Albert. At that point, Albert and his team load up and race toward Max's village. As they drive into a hot war zone, Albert prays loudly, "Lord, protect this vehicle and everyone in it. Let us just live simply on this earth and let us serve you." Dodging Russian positions and small arms fire, they reach Max and also offer to take Bogdan, but he decides to stay. This time when the brothers part, there's no arguing or anger. They hug, and Max says his goodbyes. The Kravchenkos have been trying to reach the director at one of the nearby orphanages, but can't get a hold of her. they soon find out that the director there has evacuated 105 younger orphans, leaving Max behind. Maryana understands that the director faced a very difficult decision and had to think of the younger children, especially several with disabilities. "I am just relieved that they all made it to Poland and are safe now," she offers. Only one teacher stays behind to look after the kids in the shelter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.